thank you, everyone, and good evening. I'm glad to be here. I want to thank the three co-sponsors of tonight's debate for inviting me to participate. I'd also like to say that it is an honor to share the stage once again with Shabir Ally. Many people know that Shabir is widely regarded as the finest Muslim debater in North America, perhaps even around the world. Shabir and I also first debated back in 2004. We had a collegial debate back then, and I have no reason to anticipate that tonight will be no different in that respect. So, oh, is it not on? You're right, I didn't turn it on. All right, let's start over.
No, I'm just easy. Okay. So, it's wonderful to be here, and I appreciate it. Okay, so this evening's debate concerns resurrected. Was Jesus crucified? Did he die and rise from the dead, as Christians believe? Or was he rescued from death before dying, as Muslims believe? Now, this might seem like an insignificant difference, but it's actually quite significant. You see, Paul, in Romans chapter 10, verses 9 and 13, he says, "If you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved." And then he goes on to say, "For whoever calls on the name of the Lord will be saved." When he says, "Whoever calls on the name of the Lord will be saved," he's referring back to God in Joel chapter 2. So in essence, Paul's saying, if you confess with your mouth Jesus is Yahweh, God, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you'll be saved. So amongst buying into the program of Jesus, you have to believe the right things about him, that he is God in some sense, and you have to believe that he rose from the dead. Apart from that, there's no salvation, according to the Christian view. So I'm not trying to create division here, but this was the message of Jesus' disciples from the beginning. And so, but Islam denies that Jesus is God. Islam denies that he rose from the dead. So there is distinct differences between the two. And if Jesus' disciples are correct, then Muslims are not saved. There's no salvation in Islam. So you can see that this topic we're discussing this evening is really important, at least for Christians. If Christianity is false, of course, if Jesus did not rise from the dead, well, then we can just ignore the whole thing. So what I want to do tonight is I want to present a positive case for Jesus' death by crucifixion and his resurrection. So what I want to do, Well, you have Jesus predicted his death and resurrection, okay? I don't have time to get into why. I can tell you it's in multiple independent sources, it's in early sources, and it fulfills the criterion of embarrassment. I can unpack this all later if Shabir would like to dig further into it. But if Jesus did not predict, or if Jesus predicted his death and resurrection and it didn't occur, then he's a false prophet whom no rational person should follow. Moreover, the Apostle Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians 15, he gives this argument, if Christ was not raised from the dead, then the dead will not be raised. In other words, those who follow Jesus will not be raised later on. And if the dead aren't going to be raised, then the Christian life is not worth living. But he goes on to say, but Christ has been raised, therefore we will be raised, therefore the Christian life is worth living. So, bottom line is, if Jesus did not rise from the dead, he's a false prophet, and the Christian life is not worth living. So tonight I'm going to present a positive case for Jesus' death and resurrection, and I'm going to do this giving two main points. Number one, the evidence strongly suggests that Jesus died by crucifixion and rose from the dead. And number two, Islam offers no good evidence to the contrary. So let's begin with my first major point. The evidence strongly suggests that Jesus rose, died by crucifixion and rose from the dead. And here I'm going to give two sub-points. We're going to look at primary sources, and then we're going to look at the apostolic testimony. So I'm just going to try to make this so simple that even a Southern Baptist can understand. Okay? Just teasing for those of you who are Southern Baptists. So let's start with primary sources. Okay, so these would be the sources closest to the alleged events themselves. So first of all, we have some non-Christian sources, people like Josephus, who is a Jewish historian from the late 1st century, Tacitus, a Roman historian from the early 2nd century, Lucian, a Greek writer, a historian from the middle of the second century. Marbar Serapion, a prisoner awaiting execution, who's writing probably sometime in the second century. All of these mention Jesus' execution. Some give a little more details, different details. For example, some say they list it specifically as Jesus' crucifixion. Others say it was Palestine. Others say it was at the instigation of the Jewish leadership. They don't contradict each other. They just provide supplementary information. Then we have the Gospels. Now, most scholars today, and when I say scholars, I'm talking about Christian scholars, whether conservative, moderate, liberal. I'm talking about Jewish scholars, agnostic scholars, atheist scholars. I'm a member of the Society of Biblical Literature. There are thousands of biblical scholars in there, about 8,500. And not all of them are New Testament scholars, but there's a few thousand New Testament scholars. And I can tell you, most of them are not Christians. All right, so when I say the majority of scholars tonight, I'm talking about the whole kit and caboodle. It's a very heterogeneous group of folks. Majority of scholars who comment on it and write on it and study it would say that Mark's primary source, he got his information from Peter. The majority of scholars today say that Luke, the Gospel of Luke, that his primary source, his sources of information were Paul, Mark, the Gospel of Mark, that is, a source that we have now lost, but it's a hypothetical source called Q, which is short for Quelle, the German word for just simply source, and also some other eyewitnesses. The majority of scholars likewise agree that John's primary source was one of Jesus' disciples. So pretty good information there. And then we have Paul, and Paul's going to be our most valuable source because through Paul, we're going to be able to get back with the greatest amount of certainty to what Jesus' disciples were teaching and at that time. And that's what I'm going to be looking to do this evening in terms of what happened to Jesus. Okay, so those are our primary sources. Now, in terms of the apostolic testimony, I want to talk about Paul, okay? So Paul is this young Jewish leader, a Pharisee. So he's very legalistic. If he had been a Muslim, he would have been one who is very, very supportive of Sharia law and would have followed that to the T. Paul believed that Jesus was a failed Messiah and a false prophet, and he was out to destroy the movement that Jesus had started. And then one day he had an experience that he was persuaded was the risen Jesus who appeared to him. And that experience radically transformed his life from being a persecutor of the church to one of its most able defenders. Most scholars believe that this happened within a couple of just a few years after Jesus' crucifixion. Now, Paul says in his letter to the church at Galatia, it's an undisputed letter of Paul, he says 3 years after his conversion experience, he went up to Jerusalem and he had a visit for 15 days with Peter, the lead apostle, and also he saw James, the brother of Jesus. And he wanted to go up there because he wanted to get a full accounting of Jesus, what he did during his lifetime. I think there's a good chance Paul saw and heard Jesus during his lifetime because Jesus was up there at the same time celebrating Passover, all the festivals that Paul would have been there. Jesus created all the commotion in the temple. He was there with the commotion, the things where the Jewish leadership would turn him over to Pilate. And he had to know something about Jesus' teaching to think that he was a false teacher, a false Messiah, a false prophet. Doesn't matter whether he met Jesus or not at that point, but he wasn't a follower of Jesus during Jesus' ministry on earth. So 3 years after his conversion, he goes up to Peter and he says, Pete, I want the whole nine yards, give it to me. So he learns about Jesus during that time. In Galatians chapter 2, Paul says that a little over a decade later, he goes up to Jerusalem, and now this time he meets with the pillars of the church, and he names them Peter, James, and John. Now remember, he's already met with Peter and James once, but now add John to the equation, and Peter and John were two of Jesus' three closest disciples. So you got Peter and John plus James, the brother of Jesus. And he says, guys, in Galatians, he says he wanted to run the gospel message past them that he had been preaching to make sure that he was on message, that he was preaching the same gospel message they were preaching. And so he goes in there, hey, guys, look, I just want to make sure I'm preaching the right thing here. All right, Paul, they sit down, and they say, give it to us, Paul. And so Paul runs through the gospel message. All right, Paul, why don't you step out of the room for a moment? We'll discuss it amongst themselves. Just wait out in the hall. So he goes out there. They huddle up. Well, what do you think, Pete? What do you think? How about you, Jimmy? How about you, John Boy? Oh, okay. So now they sit down at the table, all three of them. They said, tell the guy at the door, hey, get him back in here. Paul comes in, stands in front of him. James stands up and says, Paul, we've discussed it among ourselves. We've come to a conclusion. He looks Paul right in the eye with all seriousness and says, Paul, you're good, dude. Keep up the good work, man. Fist bump. All right. So according to Paul, the Jerusalem apostles certify that he's preaching the same gospel they're preaching. Now for all we know, Paul might have been making that up. How do we know he's telling the truth about that? So we look for corroborating sources. Many times in history, we never get corroborating sources. That's kind of usual. However, in this case, we're fortunate we do have corroborating sources. See, Luke corroborates it in the book of Acts. He was a traveling companion of Paul. But also, there's two guys. One's named Clement of Rome. The other's Polycarp. Oh, by some of you students in here, you're probably getting married someday. You're going to have children, a boy, maybe yours is going to be. Just remember some of these names, like Polycarp, okay? So Clement of Rome was probably a disciple of the Apostle Peter, and Polycarp was a disciple of the Apostle John. And they're both writing after Paul had died. So if Paul was lying, and his gospel message was essentially different than what Peter's and John's were, then we would expect them not to speak of Paul in laudatory terms. So it's interesting to note that in Clement's letter to the church at Corinth, it's called 1 Clement, Clement places Paul on par with his mentor Peter, and he refers to him as the blessed Paul. Polycarp, what he does is he says that Paul accurately and reliably taught the message of truth. And he quotes from Paul's letters a couple of times and refers to that as part of the sacred scriptures. This is not the kind of things you say about Paul if he was teaching a gospel that was essentially different than what Peter and John, the lead apostles, those closest to Jesus, were teaching. It's precisely the kind of things you'd say about Paul if he was teaching what they were teaching. I could give you some more evidence, but I'm limited in time. This should suffice, though, to show that Paul was telling the truth when he said he's preaching the same gospel as Jesus' disciples were. And so when we are hearing Paul on the gospel message, we are likewise, we can be absolutely confident that we are hearing an accurate echo of what Jesus' disciples were preaching. Now, wouldn't it be nice if archaeologists were digging around and they found one of Paul's lost letters, like his letter to the church at Laodicea that's mentioned in one of his letters, but we don't have it. Wouldn't it be nice if they were translating it? He goes, I want to remind you of the gospel message I preached to you. That'd be pretty cool, wouldn't it? Because then we could know, wow, we got here exactly what the Jerusalem apostles were preaching. Well, guess what? We have such a letter. We don't need the lost letter because we have such a letter, and we've had it for a very long time. It's 1 Corinthians, which was written between 20 and 25 years after Jesus' crucifixion. In chapter 15, Paul says, I want to remind you, brothers, of the gospel message I preached to you. So what's cool is what we are about to read in 1 Corinthians 15 is that echo of what Jesus' disciples were preaching. The gospel message that they certified, is that Paul's going to give them, is what they were preaching. And here's what he says. I delivered to you, when I established the church there, what I had also received from the Jerusalem apostles. That Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures. And that he was buried and that he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures. And then he gives six resurrection appearances of Jesus. To Peter, to the 12, to more than 500, to James, to all the apostles. And then finally Paul adds his own name to the list. So you got the death, Jesus' death for our sins, his burial, his resurrection, and appearances to individuals and to groups, to friend and foe alike. He said, well, what was the nature of those appearances of Jesus? What were they like? Well, Paul is going to tell us in the verses that come next, because this whole chapter, chapter 15, this whole chapter is to answer the questions of the Corinthians. Paul, is there an afterlife? If so, what's it going to be like? Are we going to be a disembodied spirit like the Gentiles believe? Or are we going to have a body? Is it going to be our body that comes back to life and rejuvenated and transformed like Jews, a lot of the Jews believe? What's it going to be like, Paul? And Paul says, well, I'm answering that for you here. You got Jesus' death for our sins, his burial, his resurrection, and appearances. Well, Paul, what does that have to do with what our afterlife is going to be like? Paul says everything. Because do you remember how Jesus was raised from the dead? Well, that's how we're going to be raised from the dead when Jesus returns. So let me describe what we have to look forward to. That's his argument in the rest of chapter 15. So you start off with verse 20, and he says, Christ has been raised, Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who are asleep. First fruits was an agricultural term referring to the first of the, to be harvested, first of the crops to be harvested. How many of you have grown a tomato plant in your front or backyard? No, almost everyone. You remember, you're watching those plants, the tomatoes grow, they start off small, and then they get big, and they're green, and then they turn yellow, and then orange, and then red, and there's one tomato that's ready before all the rest of them. You pull it off, and you slice it up, and you put it on a sandwich, or you grind it all up, and you make salsa. So you got that first one that's pulled off the tomato plant. That's called the first fruits. The rest of them are behind. They're coming, they're just not ready yet. To be asleep was a euphemism for being dead. It's like today we say he passed away rather than saying he croaked. So in antiquity they said they fell asleep and went to be with their forefathers rather than saying he died. So what Paul's saying here is Christ is to be first, the first one to be raised from the dead with a resurrection body. Okay. And so, when's everybody else going to be raised? Well, Paul answers that three verses later, but each in his own order. Christ, the first fruits, after that, those who belong to Christ at his coming, at the second coming. And then Paul says, he's going to describe that process just a few verses later. He says, at the second coming, here's what's going to happen. He says, in a moment, in the blink of an eye, at the last trumpet, when the trumpet sounds and the dead will be raised imperishable and we will be changed. For this perishable body must put on imperishability. And this mortal body must put on immortality. Paul says the same thing a little more succinctly in Romans chapter 8, verse 11. He says, if the spirit of the one who raised Jesus from the dead lives in you, the one who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies. Resurrection is something that happens to the mortal body. Okay? So the disciples, here's the bottom line here. The apostolic message, what we can trace back to what Jesus' disciples were preaching, is that he was crucified, that he died for our sins, that he was buried, that he was raised from the dead, he appeared to individuals and groups, friend and foe alike, and the nature of his resurrection involved his corpse. And this comes from the disciples, the eyewitnesses, pretty good evidence. So I think there's pretty good evidence to support my first main point, that the evidence strongly suggests that Jesus rose from the dead and appeared to them. Now what about the second main point, that Islam offers no good evidence to the contrary? Well, what evidence do the Muslims offer as evidence that Jesus did not die by crucifixion? There's really one positive evidence and only one that they can provide, and that's from the Quran. In Surah 4, verses 157 and 158, which says that Jesus did not die by crucifixion, but God only made it appear that he did. The problems with this are legion. So, for example, the Quran wasn't written 50 or 100 or even 200 years after Jesus, but 600 years later. Moreover, it doesn't contain any eyewitness testimony related to Jesus at all. Third, what it does contain are legends that were in circulation during the life of Muhammad. So, for example, you've got a legend about Jesus speaking while he's an infant in the cradle. This is originally found in the Arabic infancy gospel where Jesus says to Mary, I am the Son of God. The Quran takes it, Muhammad took it, that legend, and he recast it and placed it in the Quran. How do we know that he took it from the Arabic infancy gospel? Because after saying what Jesus says in the cradle, it says, for God does not have a son. So we know he was answering the Arabic infancy gospel. We also see where the Quran borrows from the infancy gospel of Thomas, written in the second century, where Jesus creates birds out of clay and brings them to life and they fly away. There's other legends in it as well, like it says the sun Muhammad said the sun sets in a muddy or warm spring. Well, we know that doesn't happen. And that's borrowed from the glorious deeds of Alexander, another writing that was going around during the lifetime of Muhammad. So again, it borrows from that. Moreover, it renders Jesus as a false prophet, because Jesus, we know he predicted his death. So if he didn't rise from the dead, he's a false prophet. But the Quran says he's a great prophet, so he got a pretty tough position there. So those are my 2 points. I think that they're firmly established, and I will look forward to hearing what Shabir has to say. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Cohen. Our opening statement from Dr. Ally.
Tonight, all of our loved ones, I ask God to bless all of you, your households and your families, and to put happiness and well-being in your lives, and we pray to God for more peace in the world. And that brings us to what we're trying to do here tonight. It's not Batman versus Superman. I don't want this to be a win-lose situation. I want it to be a win-win, so that we go out of here with more knowledge, with more information, with a better understanding of the two world faiths. We have a lot of discord in the world. We need to sow accord. There's a lot of hate. We need to sow love. There's a lot of war. We need to sow peace. And perhaps tonight, even though we take two very opposite positions, we will try to find ways of understanding these in the same light, or to reach agreement where such is possible. So let me then go into my presentation. Was Jesus resurrected or was he rescued? In a way, if he's resurrected, he's also rescued, but rescued in a different way. Rescued from the permanence of death, but obviously the topic means for me to say that he was rescued prior to his death. But I will add that for a Muslim, it may be possible to even think of Jesus being rescued from being dead, but from the tomb itself, rather than having him come out of the tomb, meet with his disciples for 40 days, and then finally ascending into the sky. But we'll get into the details of that later on. I'm jumping ahead of myself here a little bit. When we look at the Quranic statement, which Mike did refer to, it needs to be understood within the context of what the Quran was actually trying to establish at that point. The Quran wasn't actually directly trying to spell out all of the details about the Muslim belief regarding the death and resurrection of Jesus. What the Quran was doing was responding to the claims made by some Jews. We know that some statements are found in the Talmud, and it's not so entirely clear that they refer to Jesus, but it's easy to see that the Jews in the time of the Prophet Muhammad, when the Quran was being revealed, might have been using those statements and saying, hey, wait a minute, how was Jesus born? Was Mary married? And the Quran says, well, they're telling a great lie about Mary. They're uttering what is said in Arabic, the Qur'an al-Azima, the great calumny. And then in the same vein, they're saying, Inna qatalna al-Masiha Isa ibn Maryam. We killed the Messiah, Jesus, son of Mary. And probably you can hear this thing in their voice here. Their implication is that we killed him, and therefore we proved him to be a false Messiah. And now, the Quran's answer to that is the verse that Mike was referring to. The Quran then is defending Mary and also defending Jesus by saying they thought they had crucified him, but they didn't. They killed him not, nor did they crucify him, but so it was made to appear to them. Now, classical Muslim scholars took the term crucified in every possible meaning, and they said, well, Jesus wasn't even put on the cross. But we know that the word crucified in English, and also it's known from Hebrew and Greek and Aramaic, that the term has a dual sort of meaning. Think about Mark saying that it was the third hour when they crucified him. That's 9 o'clock on a Friday morning. Was Jesus dead by this time? No. So crucifixion at this point means, in that usage means, merely hanging him on the cross. But now think of Paul saying Jesus was crucified for our transgressions. Now he means that Jesus died for our sins, true? So, but he's using the term crucified. So we see that crucifixion can have a dual meaning. It can mean on the one hand, merely hanging a person on a cross, and on the other hand, hanging him on the cross until he dies. Now the question is, which of these two meanings does the Quran have in mind when the Quran is saying they did not crucify him? So I will argue that the meaning the Quran has in mind here is that they did not kill him by this means, even if they had actually put him on the cross. He did not actually die. So we have here a statement from the Quran, they killed him not nor crucified him. And then there is a scholar, a Cambridge scholar, Tariq Khalidi, who wrote this book entitled Muslim Jesus. And in this book, he says on page 12, in denying the crucifixion, the Quran is in fact denying that the Jews killed him. Now, many other scholars that I can name, but for lack of time, we'll proceed, have said that the Quran is not actually denying that Jesus was put on the cross. And some academic scholars today, both Muslims and non-Muslims, would go so far as to say that the Quran is not actually denying the gospel story as they are, but the Quran is just putting a new dimension on this. For example, Jeffrey Parender says that the Quran is right because the Jews didn't actually kill Jesus, it's the Romans who did it because crucifixion was a Roman type of punishment. So other details like this have been offered by academic scholars today saying that the Quran is actually not wrong on this point. The Quran is offering a different perspective on things. Some say, well, it looks like what the Quran means is that God is in full control of this, so that even though the enemies of Jesus thought that they had the upper hand on him, they don't really have the upper hand. Everything is happening according to God's plan and under his control. But I will take the view that he was actually rescued and that he did not actually die, but he was taken down alive from the cross. He was placed in a tomb, and in that tomb, and from that tomb, he was translated into heaven. But we'll get more details on that. So we need to confront the fact that there is poetic and possibly legendary narratives in the Gospels themselves. And I'm delighted to be having this dialogue with Michael Kona, because if I was having this dialogue with someone else, I would be under tremendous strain to try to prove this very point. But Mike has actually detailed this in his book, The Resurrection of Jesus, copies of which are available outside, and I would encourage you to buy it and study Mike's book. It's quite a hefty volume and a good resource for many things pertaining to the resurrection of Jesus. I will be using it for many years hence. Now, Mike says on page 186, we may also be reading poetic language or legend at certain points. Now, he offers two examples of this. One is where the four Gospels each have it that the women visiting the tomb find it empty, and they meet angels who explain to them what this is all about. Jesus is not here. He has been raised. They see the place where they laid him, and so on. So that's one example of these possibly poetic or legendary narratives in the Gospels. The other example is the resurrection of the saints, which is mentioned specifically in the Gospel according to Matthew in chapter 27, where Matthew says that at the time when Jesus died, the rocks split, the tombs were opened, and all of the dead saints came back to life. But then they didn't go back into the city immediately. Only after the resurrection of Jesus did these saints go into the city, and then they were seen by many people. According to Mike, this is possibly a poetic or legendary narrative. Now, one of the criticisms that I've seen launched at Mike's book by fellow Christians is that if you say that this particular narrative or these two sorts of narratives are legendary, how do you know which other narratives in the Gospels are legendary and which are not? So this is part of the difficulty that we need to deal with. So what scholars do is that they try to reconstruct the source material of the narratives that we have in the Gospels, the way Mike has also tried to do in his opening presentation when he was talking about sources. But let's go into some more depth. I think it's essential that we understand, and for our Muslim friends, there are four Gospels within the Christian Bible. Each one of these Gospels, named after their purported writers, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and in their own way, tell the story. Is my mic still on my ear? I felt it was a bit loose. There. Hopefully it stays right on. So, that's a map for, I went too far. Here, okay. So, that's Matt, in short for Matthew. It's not Matt Damon, but Matthew. And so this is the order in which they appear in the Bible as we have it now. However, scholars try to look at the synoptic, the relationships between these two Gospels, and they see that Mark is the source for Matthew and Luke. These three Gospels can be seen together. They're very similar in their basic outline and the stories they tell. Even sometimes word-for-word agreement can be found between the three. And John is very different. Now, most scholars agree that John is the last of the four Gospels to be written, and this is what I gather from Mike's book as well. And it's interesting for us to know that, because what you will see as you go from one Gospel to another is that the later the Gospel, the more Christian it becomes, in terms of theology, in terms of many other features, but also in terms of the death and the resurrection of Jesus. So the more certain you become that Jesus died, and the more certain you become that Jesus was raised back to life, and the more witnesses you have on the scene. Let me pick up on this last point. There is the question of the beloved disciple who was mentioned in John's Gospel. Is this a real person or just a fictional creation by the author of the fourth Gospel? You see this beloved disciple appearing where he did not appear in the other three narratives. So you have three different Gospels telling you about the life of Jesus, Mark, Matthew, and Luke, and they don't mention this beloved disciple. And then there are scenes where you wonder, you know, when that disciple appears in John's Gospel, you wonder, where did he come from? How did he fit into the scene at this point? So some scholars think this is a fictional narrative. John is painting the image of an ideal sort of disciple that every Christian should aspire to become. Well, this beloved disciple is right there at the scene of the cross, where Jesus says to him, "Behold your mother," and places Mary in the care of this beloved disciple. So John now has a male witness right there at the crucifixion scene. So if you want to know, how did they know that Jesus actually died? See, he was there on the cross. Who felt his pulse? Who knew that he actually died? Well, John has an answer. It's the beloved disciple who was there, but he's probably a fictional creation. So the later the Gospel, the more sure you can be that Jesus died, and the more sure you can be that he resurrected from the dead, the more witnesses you have, sometimes even a fictional one. Now, the scholars try to reconstruct the sources and see the relationships between these Gospels. I've already intimated that Mark, Matthew, and Luke are derived from Mark. And in fact, Mike acknowledges this in his book. And to a certain extent, he did that in his opening speeches as well. So we're on good ground here. As I said, I'm happy to be having this dialogue with Mike. We're mostly on the same page so far. But what this means is that, as Mike says, if we want to understand Matthew and Luke, we have to see them in comparison with Mark. And we can see how they develop and change the story with Mark in front of them and now what they're writing. So a case in point here for our purposes is that Mark shows that when the body of Jesus was being requested from Pilate for burial, Pilate was amazed that Jesus could have died so soon. Now, naturally, when we're reading that, we wonder, oh yeah, like how did he die so soon? Usually, a person would hang on a cross for a few days and then finally die. But in this case, we have a person on the cross only for a few hours. How did he die so soon? Now, Matthew and Luke recount that they're going neck and neck, the same narrative, stanza for stanza, and then suddenly they don't mention that Pilate asked this question. Why? According to Raymond Brown, the best explanation for that is that Matthew and Luke did not want their readers to have the same doubts in their minds that was created when they were reading Mark's gospel. Now you must realize that that's why I've shown them to be on scrolls, because initially when these gospels were written, they were in separate scrolls and circulated in different areas. One who read one was not necessarily reading the other. So somebody is reading Mark and having that doubt. Matthew and Luke did not want their readers, who could be different people, having the same doubt. So we proceed and give some dates to this. Well, Mike says that the Gospels were written 3 to 7 decades after Jesus. So that's about 60 to 100. I've given approximate dates for these Gospels based on that large schema and what I know from scholars more generally, that Mark was written around 65, Matthew and Luke around 85, and John's Gospel by 100 CE. So now, you see the situation that Jesus came and he left. And then for several decades, for 3 decades at least, the stories about Jesus were being told orally and passed on and elaborated upon and preached about until eventually they were put into writing. So naturally those stories were developed, they evolved in several directions. And some of them picked up greater speed than others. And eventually these writers are each making selections from that wider pool of oral tradition and including them. Now, the fact that a gospel is late does not mean that all of it is false, because this gospel, for example, could be borrowing an oral tradition which was still being circulated all around and eventually comes in the gospel according to John. So what we do, what scholars do, is they try to retrace every single episode to their origins and see how the stories developed and changed and try to decipher the difference between the original and the later narratives. I've eliminated John from this picture for the so we can simplify the diagram and I can include more complex items, so it's not getting easier for you. I'm sorry about this, but this is standard. This is what they teach in an introductory course on the New Testament in universities in America. And now I want to introduce the pre-Markan narrative. That's where Mark would have got his information from. So if we saw that Matthew and Luke were improving upon Mark, did Mark improve upon his source as well? And the answer to that is yes. And scholars like Wolfgang Pannenberg have said that where Mark has it, that the women visited the tomb and the angel spoke to them and said, go tell his disciples that he's going before them to meet them in Galilee. According to Pannenberg, Mark chapter 16, verse 7, that says this is not original to the story. The pre-Markan narrative did not have this, neither did it have Mark 14, 28. You can look that up on your own time. I'm just mentioning that for completeness. But both of them go to indicate that Jesus is going to Galilee and he's going to appear to his disciples. That was not in the pre-Markan story. So Mark himself has added that to the narrative. So you see that the story is developing as we go from time to time. I haven't given the date for the pre-Markan narrative because nobody knows when it was actually composed or whether it was oral or written. Now, another source that Mike mentioned in his opening presentation is the Q document. Matthew and Luke not only wrote based on Mark, but they had another important document, a document which scholars call Q. I didn't show it as a scroll because it is not certain, absolutely, that this was a written document, though many scholars believe it was a written document. It doesn't affect my point now. The important thing is that when Q is reconstructed, it is found that Q does not mention the death of Jesus. So the question for scholars is, how do you have a document, which was obviously a Christian document, that told us about the teachings of Jesus, but did not say anything about his death? Whereas Paul made so much about the death of Jesus and made it so central. And many scholars think that there were communities for which the death of Jesus was not important. But we'll come to more details about Q. So here's a complete picture that Matthew and Luke are based on Mark and Q. This is what we've already gone through. But now I'm going to insert the pre-Markan narrative there as well. And finally, I'm going to put in Paul's works. Paul wrote from about 50 to 64 CE when he finally died. Now you can see that Paul's writings predated the Gospels that we have now. And I would argue that they largely influenced the Gospels that we have now. And finally, I want to introduce you to this book by Daniel Smith. Mike is familiar with another book by Daniel Smith, for which Mike wrote a critique. And this book, I think, is very important. This is his PhD thesis, now published, the postmortem vindication of the postmortem vindication of Jesus in the Saints' Gospel Q. What Sir Daniel Smith has argued for in this book is that when we look at the sayings in the Q Gospel, it is clear that Jesus was speaking about his assumption, his meaning his ascension, is another word for ascension, his ascension, but it would seem that when this information is combined with the Gospel according to Mark in its pre-Markan state, then we realize that there was a belief in a community that Jesus was actually assumed, ascended into heaven, translated into heaven right from the tomb. Now the question is, when he was translated into heaven from the tomb, had he died prior to that, or was he translated alive? Mostly in tradition, such persons were translated alive, such as Enoch and Elijah. And Dieter Zeller points to the fact that the sign of Jonah that is mentioned in the Q narrative would indicate that Jesus was actually taken alive. Now, that's not Daniel Smith's particular view. He thinks that Jesus died and then was taken from the tomb, according to this belief, an early Christian belief. But Dieter Zeller, I think, has hit an important point here in noting that there was an early Christian belief that Jesus was actually taken from the tomb, but not following death, but while he was still alive. I think that corresponds to the Muslim belief that I have explained to be based on the Quran, that did not kill him for certain, but he was taken up by God alive. Thank you very much.
Thank both of our speakers for their opening statements, and now we'll have a 10-minute rebuttal in which each of our speakers can address the other points made.
Well, thank you,
Turn on your Z, I remind you.
Well, thank you, Shabir. I appreciate that opening statement you had. Okay, remember my opening statement, I said I'd be making two main points. Number one, the evidence strongly suggests that Jesus died by crucifixion and rose from the dead. And number two, Islam offers no good evidence to the contrary. So now I'd like to review those two main points in light of what Shabir just said. Let's begin with my first major point, that the evidence strongly suggests that Jesus died by crucifixion and rose from the dead. Now, Shabir, let's look at my primary sources here. He called some of these into question, saying, you've got legends in the Gospels that I acknowledged this in my big book. Well, that's not necessarily the case. He mentions the angels, and what in my book I said that some think that the angels at the empty tomb were legendary, and I mentioned Raymond Brown, but I also assessed his arguments and said that I found them wanting. I did not find them persuasive. In terms of Matthew's raised saints, or the saints raised at Jesus' death in Matthew chapter 27, I did posit that that was not a legend, but a compositional device, special effects, that was a common compositional device used by Greco-Roman and Jewish authors, and I provided examples. It'd be like today if we said the events of 9/11 were earth-shaking. We really don't mean that in the literal sense. It's an idiom that we use in English, and I can show many examples in antiquity where they used things like phantoms coming back at sunset during an event that had cosmic or even divine significance. So I don't think it's a legend. I do think it was a compositional device. And of course, someone, you know, Shabir is saying, well, if you have that legend, what else did it, he says, what else could Matthew have invented? Well, I think you got to look at these things, and you look at it on a case-by-case basis. He didn't invent the resurrection, because, of course, Paul and the disciples were preaching this decades before Matthew even wrote his gospel. Even if we go by the dates that Shabir provided, 85, he said, for Matthew, Paul's writing 1 Corinthians no later than the year 55. That's three decades before, and he's getting this from the Jerusalem apostles, who are the alleged eyewitnesses themselves. So we go right back to the Jerusalem apostles. This isn't something that Matthew made up. Okay, so then he says, well, you've got elaborations between these Gospels that as you get old, long, further along, they become more Christianized. You see oral tradition that gets corrupted, and there's elaboration. Well, I would just respond to that, no, that's not the way oral tradition worked. It's not like the game of telephone where you whisper in someone's ear, and they pass it around to the back, and you got something totally different. I once said that, you know, with that, you've got children here and an unimportant sentence one time, and then they quickly and playfully pass that along to one another in an uncontrolled manner. That's not how oral tradition worked. And I once had a kindergarten teacher said, you know, Mike, I do that with my kids all the time, but then you know what I do? I do something extra. I give them a new sentence and say, now you pass that back, and if you don't get it perfect, by the time you get to the end, there's no recess today. And they get it perfect every time. And the reason being is they have a reason to do it. But do you think the early Christians would have had a reason to pass this along and keep it intact since this meant eternal life to them? Well, of course. And then you can see recent ways that they did pass it along. You just go to 1 Corinthians 11, where Paul gives the Eucharistic sayings of Jesus at the Last Supper about this is my body, which is broken for you. This is my blood, which is shed for you. And then you go to Luke, who writes, according to Shabir's dates here, about 30 years later, and it's virtually word for word. Word for word. So you can see how it was passed along this in its integrity. So it's not like this game of telephone. Besides, remember I showed in my opening statement how through Paul, he had his gospel message verified, certified by the Jerusalem apostles that he was preaching what they were preaching. Shabir never addressed this. And there we get Jesus' crucifixion, that he died for our sins, that he was buried, that he was raised, that he appeared to individuals and groups, to friend and foe alike, and that the nature of those appearances, resurrection, involved the corpse. Shabir never addressed that. Okay, then he says, when it comes, well, the beloved disciple and John is not mentioned in the other Gospels. Well, he could be. It could be John. Many, including myself, think that that's the Apostle John. And he is the eyewitness, and he refers to himself as the disciple whom Jesus loved. But if it's not John, it's a minor disciple. And the majority of scholars today say that the beloved disciple, that's the testimony of one of Jesus' disciples, who's the primary source for John's gospel. Well, then, about Jesus' death, I mentioned that. He says, well, Pilate was surprised that Jesus had died so soon in the earliest gospel, Mark. He was surprised, okay? But I would encourage Shabir to read the text. Just read the text. It says that when Joseph of Arimathea came to and requested the body of Jesus, Pilate was surprised that Jesus had died so soon. So he summoned the centurion, and the centurion verified that Jesus was dead. The text could not be more clear that Jesus was dead. Shabir mentions about the Q source. It doesn't have Jesus' death. That is correct. It doesn't have Jesus' death in the Q source. But the problem is that our means of identifying Q are very limited. The Q material, is what appears in Matthew and Luke, but is absent from Mark. So it's entirely possible that Q included a narrative of Jesus' death and resurrection, and maybe it's included, Matthew used them, but Luke chose another source. In that case, Q could have included Jesus' death and resurrection, and we'd never know it because of our means of identifying Q are so limited. Moreover, Q could have absolutely been notes of one of Jesus' disciples who had taken Jesus' teachings, and then these later got expanded with additional traditions of Jesus, because Q is a saying source. It just has the teachings of Jesus. So if this was the case, we can understand why it wouldn't have anything about Jesus' death and resurrection. They hadn't occurred yet when he took these notes. What about raised from the dead? Shabir talks about a pre-Markan narrative that doesn't have Mark chapter 16, verse 7, where they fled from the tomb, the disciples, the angel announced that the disciples will see Jesus in Galilee. I don't think there are any good reasons to believe that this verse wasn't in a pre-Markan source. The fact is that scholars are not in any agreement whatsoever on what a pre-Markan source would have included. Now, I believe there was a pre-Markan source. I think it was Peter, because that's what the church tradition says where Mark got his primary information. And remember, I established in my opening statement that we can go right back to the Jerusalem apostles and show that they were proclaiming Jesus' death, his resurrection, his appearances to others, and that this was a bodily appearance. And again, Shabir never bothered to talk about that. What about the sign of Jonah? Shabir says, Dieter Zeller says the sign of Jonah meant that Jesus was alive. Well, I think in that kind of case, I have to admit, the sign of Jonah, he was alive when he went into the great fish, he was alive in the fish, he was alive when he came out. So it could very well be that it meant Jesus meant that. But it could mean Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection as well. So what do you do when you have a vague or ambiguous verse? Proper interpretational principles tell us to look at what else the same person says. So let's just stay in Matthew, because that's where the sign of Jonah is. And you go to Matthew chapter 16, verse 21. From that time, Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things from the elders and chief priests and scribes, and be killed, and on the third day be raised. Matthew 17, 22 and 23. As they gathered in Galilee, Jesus said to them, the Son of Man is about to be delivered into the hands of men, and they will kill him, and he will be raised on the third day. So Jesus twice says in Matthew he's going to die and be raised on the third day. So what do you think he means in the same book, the same gospel, when he talks about the sign of Jonah? It's pretty clear he's talking about his death, burial, and resurrection. Then he talks about Shabir in terms of the bodily resurrection. He says Daniel Smith's doctoral dissertation, he talks about assumption into heaven rather than death, and then a pre-Markan source. Again, we don't know much about a pre-Markan source, really nothing about it. And that doesn't mention really anything about Jesus' resurrection. Daniel Smith argues this. Well, I know Daniel Smith. He's a friend of mine. We've talked on a couple of occasions. We've emailed. In fact, we reviewed one another's book for the Review of Biblical Literature. I disagree with Daniel. He's just simply wrong on this. And I said it in my review. You can look it up on bookreviews.org. And the problem is, we can go right back to what the Jerusalem apostles were saying. What were they teaching? Jesus' death, burial, resurrection, his appearances, and that he was raised physically from the dead. One final thing, that settles my first major point. My second is that the Quran offers no good evidence to the contrary. Shabir talked about how the Quran says that, it could be the Romans killed him instead of just the Jews. That's a stretch, and he knows it. And besides, if it meant that, and they could accommodate Jesus' death and resurrection, well, then it agrees with the Gospels in the New Testament, and I would encourage him and all Muslims here to become Christians in that case. If it's not, then that renders Jesus a false prophet, because Jesus predicted his death and resurrection, and the Quran says he didn't, so that would make him a false prophet. And in that, if you believe that, and you're a Muslim, then I'd say leave Islam, because the Quran says he's a great prophet, so it contradicts the Quran, and so I don't think there's good evidence from the Quran. We have every good reason to believe that Jesus died by crucifixion and that he rose from the dead. Thank you.
No, I must remember to turn my mic on.
I didn't.
Oh, you know what? I haven't turned it off. Sorry, guys, if the battery runs out. So, ready to go? Okay. Now, folks, I'm so glad that. Oops. Shouldn't have put a heavy book. See, that's how big my book is. No one predicted a book would have been so massive. Okay. So, fix my hat. I need to fix his hat. Okay. So, I may have misunderstood what Mike said about angels. So, in the light of what he just said, I had to look at it one more time, and I'll read what he wrote on the page I was looking at, and see if it says something different than what I was saying. On page 185, Mike writes, It can forthrightly be admitted that the data surrounding what happened to Jesus is fragmentary and could possibly be mixed with legend, as Wedderburn notes. We may also be reading poetic language or legend at certain points, such as Matthew's report of the raising of some dead saints at Jesus' death, then he gives the verse number, and the angels at the tomb, then he gives the verse numbers. To me, he was agreeing with that statement. It's his own statement, but anyway, he's here in person, he can tell us what exactly he means. Now, as for Dieter Zeller wasn't referring to Matthew's Gospel's statement about this sign of Jonah. Dieter Zeller was referring to that statement about the sign of Jonah as it is derived from the Q Gospel. And in that Gospel, there's no mention of death. And so it all ties in together. Jesus is speaking about the sign of Jonah. Jonah was obviously, as you know, alive in the belly of the whale or fish, depending on which translation you use. And from there, he was taken out alive. So the comparison is that Jesus obviously is going to be preserved alive. Now, if we come to Matthew's Gospel, he is put in a tomb like the belly of the whale, and now he is taken out alive and remaining alive all of this time. What about the passion predictions? Well, I wouldn't take the passion predictions as authoritatively and authentically from Jesus. Notice that when the crucifixion is about to happen, the disciples are all in confusion and they flee from the scene. And when this tomb is discovered empty according to the Gospels, nobody knows what to make of this. Mary Magdalene's first response is to say, they've taken away the body and we don't know where they have laid him. So nobody at this point thinks, oh, well, yeah, that's right. Jesus said he was going to raise from the dead, didn't you remember? Even when it says in John's Gospel that the disciples went to the tomb, Peter and the beloved disciple again, now finally they're putting pieces together. And John says, for to this time, they did not yet understand the scripture that Jesus is to rise from the dead. So here is the idea that the Old Testament scripture somehow says that Jesus is going to rise from the dead, but nothing is being recalled from Jesus himself saying that he must rise from the dead. So all of these passion predictions, according to many scholars, are fictional creations by the writers of the Gospels. It is not something that Jesus himself spoke about. It takes care of a major point that Mike was making, that the Quran must be wrong because Jesus predicted his passion. So if the Quran denies his death, that means the Quran is denying what Jesus said. And since the Quran said that Jesus is a prophet, now Jesus would have to be a false prophet because he predicted his death, which didn't really happen according to the Quran. Now we're seeing that he didn't actually predict his death. Now, in terms of the early preaching of the disciples, Mike is saying that, the disciples were preaching that Jesus died and he was buried and so on. But read Acts of the Apostles and you will see that, in fact, the early preaching seems to indicate that Jesus remained alive all the while. Look at Peter speaking in Acts chapter 2. Certainly, in the way it now appears, Jesus died. True. But what is Peter referring to prove the whole scenario about Jesus? He's referring to Psalms chapter 16. Now, the 16th Psalm actually speaks about somebody who, according to the interpreter's one-volume commentary on the Bible, somebody who had a close brush with death, not somebody who actually died. Now, go to Acts chapter 4. Peter is again preaching about the death of Jesus, and he refers to Jesus as that stone, which was rejected but became the capstone. Remember that saying of Jesus in the Gospels? Now, Peter is saying, you want to know who that stone is? It is Jesus. Okay, so where do you get this from? Psalm 118. Go to Psalm 118. What does it speak about? It speaks about somebody praying to God saying, rescue me. Don't let me die. And he actually specifically says, I did not die. Now, the Gospels speak about the crucifixion scene. And not knowing what specifically happened, they went to the Old Testament to find what they thought might have been predictions about somebody being crucified. So they picked on some Psalms, and they picked on the book of Isaiah. So what Psalms did they pick on? Psalm 22. When Jesus was on the cross, what did he utter? Elahi, Elahi, lima sabachthani, my God, why have you forsaken me? Where does that come from? Psalm 22. Some Muslims listening to that will say, well, that doesn't sound like Jesus on the cross. I don't think like a prophet would be making this kind of cry of dereliction. We're all called to have faith in God no matter what the circumstance. Did he lose his faith at this moment? Well, Christian commentaries on the Bible say no. They say that Jesus must have had in mind the entire Psalm 22, not just the opening words. And when he mentions these opening words, that is like a code way of referring to the entire Psalm. So what does the entire Psalm show? The entire psalm shows, especially towards the end, that this person is going to be rescued right here and now from out of his situation of distress. So the rescue Jesus, when he was saying this, means that he wouldn't die. Still with the Psalms. The Gospel of Mark shows that when the passers-by see Jesus on the cross, they say, aha, he who did all of these wonderful things, let him come down from the cross and so on. So they think, aha, well, where does this statement, aha, come from? Where did Mark get it from? From Psalm 40 and Psalm 70. Well, there, in those two Psalms, it is clear that while the people are saying, aha, regarding the man of God, this man of God is praying to God, please rescue me and don't let me die. Psalm 22 shows, actually, that God listened to the prayer of this person. Now, Hebrews chapter 5 shows that God heard him in the days when he cried out for help and saved him from that which he was distressed about. The Gospel according to Luke shows that an angel came down to strengthen Jesus, meaning to make him ready to go on the cross. But now we're seeing that even while he was on the cross, he was praying to be rescued and saved from death. All of this material shows that the Muslim position is actually based on good ground. Now, I didn't argue here that because the Quran says so, therefore it must be true. I'm showing that what the Quran actually says, even if we discard the Quran altogether, we're seeing that Christian scholars, in peeling back the pages of their scripture, are finding that the earliest declaration about Jesus prior to the belief that he resurrected and came back and met his disciples and then ascended to heaven, the earlier declaration from prior to this was that Jesus was actually taken from the tomb. Daniel Smith thinks he was taken after he died, but still from the tomb. And Dieter Zeller is saying, no, he was taken while still alive, if we give credence to the statement as it is found in the Q Gospel. And I'm saying that that corresponds to the Muslim belief. But of course, for Muslims, the Quran is the word of God. It doesn't matter if it came 600 years later or 6 million years later. If it is the word of God, then we believe it because it is the word of God. Christians would have said that about the New Testament Gospels. This is the inspired word of God, therefore we believe what it says. But you can see that Christian scholars are not going that route now. They have critically examined the Christian scriptures, and they have found it wanting in many ways. But for Muslims, there is still very good confirming evidence that the Quran is the word of God. I'll mention only one such thing. It comes from the world of mathematics. People are studying the Quran from a mathematical point of view, and they're finding that there are things in the Quran which seem to be arranged according to some mathematical pattern. And this points to the signature of God. A book is written to convey a message, not to have a deep mathematical code, but we're noticing things. For example, what do you make of the fact that the word for month in the singular occurs in the Quran just 12 times? Now you're thinking somebody might have counted them, right? But the word for day in the singular without any suffixes also occurs in the Quran 365 times. Is that a mere coincidence, or is that by somebody doing the count and making sure it came up like this? Now what we know from the Quran leads us to believe that there wasn't any human being who was doing this counting. This is evidence that the Quran is the word of God. No time to elaborate on this further, but Muslims, I believe, are on very good ground in believing the Quran as the word of God. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you, Carolyn. Great opening statements and rebuttal. And now we're going to engage each speaker with one another. We're going to allow each to question one another for 10 minutes. And we're going to start with Dr. Licona to get the question in 10 minutes.
Okay, let's just go down with some of the things in order here that Shabir said. All right, we've talked about the angels and the raised saints, and you said that I said that these are legendary, and you read a quote from 185. Maybe if you want to turn there and look at the footnote that I put there, that's where I said these could be candidates for it, but then I go in the footnote and say that Brown suggests that the angels are legendary, but that's where I say Brown's mistaken, and I give reasons why. And then I do treat the raising of the saints later on, and I say, well, that's not legendary, and that's in chapter 5. So, I mean, if you want to read the footnote there, it's fine. Acts chapter 2, I think you're right that in when Peter quotes Psalm 16, verse 10, in that psalm, it's David saying, "You will not allow my Holy One to see decay," meaning David expects that God is going to rescue him from death. I agree with you there. But do you have a New Testament on you?
Yes.
Okay, would you just read? Just read on down in the same chapter and read what Peter in the same sermon says in verses 23 and 24. He talks about that, David, quotes from Psalm 16:10, but I'd like to, in the same sermon again, verses 23 and 24, would you read those in Acts chapter 2?
Sure. 23, "And the man delivered up by the set plan and foreknowledge of God you killed, using lawless men to crucify him, but God raised him up, releasing him from the throes of death, because it was impossible for him to be held by it."
All right, so the same Peter who's quoting Psalm 16:10 is the same Peter in the same chapter, in the same sermon, who's saying Jesus died and rose from the dead. Can you tell me why you're not using a careless reading of the text in order to try to introduce doubt here about Jesus' death when the very text you're appealing to says Jesus died and rose from the dead?
I made it plain in my presentation of this that it is true that Peter is saying that Jesus died in this passage, but whether that's originally from Peter is another issue, because as you said in your book, Acts has to be adjusted for a certain embellishment. Acts is leading the story in a certain direction, in a Christian direction. And so we want to peel back from this story and see what was the original situation. Now, the original situation seems to be that Peter, and if this may not be original, but it's an earlier situation. Peter is appealing to Psalm 16. And Psalm 16 speaks about somebody whose body will not undergo decomposition.
Right, so how do you know that Peter hasn't reinterpreted this here for Jesus? I mean, obviously, in this context, he has reinterpreted to apply to Jesus.
Well, what I'm saying, first of all, is that we have to look at the clues here. If we don't want to be detective and we just want to take the official line in a story, then fine, that's the official line. Jesus died, he resurrected from the dead, he met with his disciples, he finally ascended to heaven. That's the official line. But when writers are writing the official line, but they leave traces of an earlier version of the story, now that becomes interesting. The trace of the earlier version of the story here is that they are referring to a person whose body did not decompose. Now, it is also possible that at the time when people were thinking of this, they did not have the clear senses we have today to differentiate between somebody who is in a state of coma and somebody who is actually finally dying.
Yeah, but now, on the cross you would.
But we know that decomposition and death go together. If a person has died, his body becomes decomposed. If his body is not decomposing, that means he has not died. So you have said in your book that this passage means that the person did not, his body did not suffer decomposition.
That's correct.
So if his body did not suffer decomposition, that means Jesus did not die. Now the logic of the story...
I don't find that, Shabir. And you have the same guy who's... I think it's quite a stretch for you to say that he's quoting this and there's a pre-Acts source. Remember, Luke got his information from eyewitnesses. He got it from Paul, he got it from Mark, he got it from Q. And so these are eyewitnesses. And again, that does not do anything to address the arguments I gave for how we can get back to what the Jerusalem apostles themselves were proclaiming, that Jesus died and that he rose and appeared to them because his corpse had been raised.
Well, let me address the idea that Luke is getting this from Paul and these there and other.
I'll tell you what, I would rather you, because we're limited in time, I'd rather you address what I've said about this goes right back to the Jerusalem apostles themselves. I gave arguments through Paul. He has his gospel message certified by the Jerusalem apostles in preaching what they're preaching. They're preaching Jesus' death, resurrection, and bodily resurrection. So how do you address that, the evidence that I gave?
Well, it is not so clear that what Paul is saying actually goes back to the Jerusalem apostles. Paul is saying that this is tradition I have received. He doesn't say who he received it from.
Well, he did say he got it certified from the Jerusalem apostles. And we do have Polycarp and Clement of Rome.
I think you're tying pieces together here. But when Paul in 1 Corinthians is not saying I got this from the Jerusalem apostles. Elsewhere, elsewhere he says, I met with the Jerusalem apostles. But elsewhere he also says, what I'm teaching I did not receive from any man. I got it as a revelation from God.
Right.
So it is possible that Paul received this information from other sources other than the original Jerusalem apostles.
Well, in terms of the credo, the formula that has been given down, but still, the content of that, we know that he ran that by the Jerusalem apostles, and they agreed, hey, that's what we're preaching.
I think you're reading things into the meetings. When the meetings were convened in Jerusalem, it was about dietary law. Should we impose dietary law on the Gentiles? There was no meeting convened to say, okay, what are we going to agree to preach about the resurrection of Jesus?
Well, Acts mentions the dietary laws and the Jewish law, whether Gentiles can be part of it and whether they need to be circumcised, male need to be circumcised and all that. But Paul does say that they certified that he's running the gospel message, so it doesn't mean that they didn't discuss that as well. And remember, Polycarp said that Paul accurately and reliably taught the message of truth. Let me move on, though, a little bit. I don't want to get caught up on this. You talked about how you've got Dieter Zeller said that Matthew, the sign of Jonah, was not referring to Matthew, but the sign of Jonah, but the Q, in which there's no mention of Jesus' death. So what do you do with my argument here that Q could very well have been notes taken by Jesus, one of Jesus' disciples, while he was still alive, and so therefore it wouldn't mention his death and resurrection?
It's a far stretch to say that somebody took notes as Jesus was preaching while he was still alive.
Why? Because other disciples and teachers did that. That was common.
There is no trace in the early church that anyone had notes from which they preached the sayings of Jesus.
That's an argument for silence.
And the way in which the teaching material about Jesus was being handled in the gospel showed that there was no authoritative teaching from Jesus. People wrote, and others thought it within their, they thought they had the authority to change what was being said. So, for example, we have the same saying of Jesus appearing in various Gospels, apparently the same saying, but with significant modifications. We have people introducing statements into the mouth of angels, for example. You spoke about the angels at the tomb. Well, in Mark's Gospel, the angels say, go tell my disciples to meet me in Galilee. But as he told you, well, because he had already told them in Mark 14:28. But in Matthew's gospel, it doesn't say, as I told you. It says, I have told you.
Right.
Why? Because Matthew is leaving the scene open for for Jesus to appear to the women. And he's going to tell the women himself.
That's true. But so, you do have a common device in antiquity called transferal. We find it in Plutarch. We find it in Suetonius. We find it in Sallust and all this.
But
this
then a lot of things that might have been transferred and put in the mouth of Jesus that he didn't
well,
say.
Well, the message is still the same. Okay.
I mean, you're assuming that, Mike, but we're
no, because
here,
this is a common literary device that most authors use. Let me move on to Hebrews 5:7, because I'm running out of time here. You said in Hebrews, you appeal to that where it says Jesus offered prayer to him who could save him from death, and his prayers were answered. That could mean that he was rescued from death. It could also have a different meaning. So let's look at what else Hebrews says. Chapter 2, verse 9. Jesus, because of the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, so that by the grace of God he might taste death for everyone. Five verses later, verse 14. Now, since the children have flesh and blood in common, Jesus also shared in these, so that through death he might destroy the one holding the power of death, that is the devil. Chapter 13, verses 20 and 21. Now may the God of peace, who brought up from the dead the great shepherd of the sheep through the blood of the eternal covenant, Jesus our Lord. So obviously, the author of Hebrews thought that Jesus had died. He says it three times, and he mentions resurrection once. I think it's a more plausible explanation that this author, who believes in Jesus' death and resurrection, means when he said his prayers were answered, that God brought him up from, he didn't allow him to meet, and he resurrected him. How would you address that?
Well, that passage that I'm referring to in Hebrews specifically says that God heard him in that very manner in which he feared. And now, of course, the rest of Hebrews is saying that Jesus died. I'm not denying that. That's the official line. But is there an earlier tradition, though, in which it was recalled that Jesus made this prayer and his prayer was answered? I'm showing from all of these signs, yes, that was the earlier prayer. He was, even on the cross, or even in that situation of great distress, if he applied to Jesus that to Jesus while he was on the cross, that's when he's making that prayer, and that's when God rescues him and saves him
from death. That's the earlier tradition.
Well, now, but you have no evidence book, that that's an
in
earlier
book,
tradition. Not at all. Nothing written, nothing. It's pure speculation.
In the book Deconstructing Jesus by Robert Price says that Muslim scholars have pointed to clues for a long time. And
Robert Price
that.
Denies the existence of Jesus, period.
Using literary techniques, Robert Price is saying, now we can look at these clues that were pointed out by Muslim scholars, and we're seeing, yeah, there are clues here pointing to an idea that Jesus was actually rescued and saved from death.
And use those same clues to deny Jesus' existence.
But that's another matter. But do these clues point to the idea that Jesus might have been rescued from death? And I think yes.
Okay. Shabir, you have 10 minutes to cross the table. Ask your question.
Okay. Mike, I don't want to like put you on the spot or anything. I just want to get your ideas because you're a scholar. And here is a book, Acts and Christian Beginnings, from the Acts Seminar. Are you familiar with this book by Dennis Smith and Joseph Tyson?
I am not.
Okay. And then I would recommend that you get a copy and read it. Why? Because you rely on the age-old convention that Luke was a companion of Paul and that he wrote probably around 85, even as I put up there on the screen.
Which
that
is the view of the majority of scholars.
Yes. And now there is an emerging group of scholars. This is the result of 10 years of study by the people we know as the Jesus Seminar. Now they're the Acts Seminar. Over 10 years to study Acts of the Apostles. And their conclusion is that Acts of the Apostles is not written by a traveling companion of Paul, but was written probably around the year 115. And this answers a lot of the puzzles that previously struck us, because we know that there are discrepancies between Paul's statements, for example, in Galatians, and what is actually found in Acts. And you've alluded to that in your book as well. So this solves the problem. And now what they're saying is that Acts of the Apostles was written by somebody who wanted to rehabilitate Paul. Why? Because in the first part of the second century, Marcion was using Paul's writings to champion a particular brand of Christianity which did not become mainstream. And Acts of the Apostles wanted to bring the writings of Paul and Paul's character himself into the mainstream. And so Acts of the Apostles shows, yes, that when Paul comes to Jerusalem, the disciples meet him, there is some hesitation, but eventually they're getting along. Though not extremely quite well, but you can see that they're getting along. So I think you need to now take into consideration that the support that you thought that Paul had in Acts of the Apostles may not be so very strong, because Acts of the Apostles itself is not an unbiased source, but thoroughly biased towards Paul.
Okay, well, first of all, bias doesn't mean you're wrong. If that were the case, then African-American historians could never write on slavery in the U.S. A Jewish historian could never write on the Holocaust, okay? So bias doesn't mean you're wrong. It just means that you were there for a cause. And if Jesus was who he claimed to be and he rose from the dead, well, then the disciples, yes, they're biased about the message, but rightly so. I'm biased. I believe that Jesus is who he claimed to be. I believe he rose from the dead. So yes, I'm biased toward the Christian message. You're biased toward the Muslim message. That doesn't mean that either of us are wrong because we're biased. In terms of the book there written by the Jesus Seminar, nobody pays much attention to them anymore. They were very popular in the 90s and the early 2000s, but they are a group of scholars on the radical left. There's about 150 of them that signed up for it in a whole history of the Jesus Seminar. Many of them are dead, so it's less than that now. Many of the Jesus Seminar fellows deny the existence of God. If you want to say that they're unbiased scholars, well, that's a far cry. John Dominic Carlson is an atheist. Stephen Patterson, another prominent fellow, doesn't believe that God exists in any sense like the Muslim, Christian, Abrahamic God, that if God exists at all, he's just a force, an impersonal force, and when we die, there's no afterlife, if so, it's more like we're absorbed into the universe. So their views are quite a bit different than ours, a lot of the Jesus Seminar fellows. I'm going to rely more on, and by the way, there's usually no more than 30 or 40 of them, according to what Stephen Patterson told me, who even vote on these things. So it's not even that much of an emergence number of scholars. It's a radical group of scholars on the way out there on the fringe of the theological left and not in touch with mainstream scholarship. If you want to know where mainstream scholarship is on Acts, I'd encourage you to read Craig Keener's seminal four-volume work on the commentary on the Book of Acts, which is over 5,000 pages. 624 pages itself just devoted to the introduction of Acts. And there he talks about where the majority of scholars are today. And he says the majority of scholars do hold that Luke, the author of Acts, was a traveling companion of Paul.
Of course, I looked into Brett Kuehner's work, and I found that Brett Kuehner is admitting that he is writing from a conservative Christian point of view. So naturally, he's biased the other way. I think we need to take all of these writings into consideration.
But he's not the majority of scholars.
Well, he probably means the majority of conservative scholars.
No, not at all. Because he cites Richard Perlow and all these guys who think Acts is a novel.
I can cite many scholars who, for example, Ernest Henschen, in Commentary and Acts of the Apostles. Several scholars think that the idea that Luke was a traveling companion of Jesus is actually not on very sound basis.
Well, that's true, but the majority of scholars would disagree.
Well, it depends on how you define who is a scholar, because what
a
I
person sense who has a PhD in a relevant field and has published peer review.
Well, they may also be starting out as Christians who decide to pursue a PhD in that field because they are really believing Christians, and that's what they want to study, and that's what they want to defend. Just like, for example, yourself, and just like I pursued Islamic study, I'm already a Muslim. But if we don't get caught up with who's a scholar, who is not, and who has the PhD and who doesn't, we look at the facts of the matter, and we see that there are discrepancies between what Paul says about himself and what is said in Acts of the Apostles. If Acts of the Apostles was written by a traveling companion of Paul, these discrepancies are difficult to explain. But I want to shift around
here. Well, they're not difficult to explain.
You have spoken about Paul's statement about Jesus being dead, and now he's in a glorified body. Now, it seems to me, and I want to run this by you, it seems to me that Paul is saying that, okay, Jesus was raised up, and he is now clothed with that heavenly body which he had previously left in heaven. Because for Paul, Jesus was a heavenly figure. He came down, left that heavenly form. He came down to the form of a servant. Now he leaves the form of a servant, and now he goes back to be clothed with the heavenly body. So the comparison breaks down here with the ordinary Christian because, or with Christians in general, because Christians in general did not start out in heaven and leave the heavenly body to go back to. So their bodies will be transformed. So that does not mean that Jesus' body was transformed. It just simply means he came into this world, adopted a body, he left the body like the clothing that we wear, and he put back on the heavenly body that he had left in heaven in the first place. How do you respond to that?
Well, I think you misinterpreted Philippians chapter 2, verses 6 through 11, when it says that, that Jesus existed in the form of God. He uses the term morphe there, and in the context, I think when you take it contextually, that is used to mean the role of God. So he existed in the role of God. He didn't regard that role as something to hold on to, but he emptied himself of that role in the divine lifestyle, and he took on the role of a servant. Not the form, because then later on, and being found in appearance as human, okay, he took on that. He took on the role of a servant, but then he took on human appearance, okay? So it's a role that he's talking about there. He gave up that role, that divine role, and took on the role of a servant. That's why Jesus is reported in Mark, the earliest gospel, saying the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. So he took on the role of a servant, had nothing to do with his body.
Isaiah 53 is often used as a reference to the death of Jesus, but you're aware that Isaiah 53, the Dead Sea Scrolls copy, does not mention death in Isaiah 53:9. How do you reconcile that with what we've been discussing? Because it seems to be proof in my favor that the passage which was looked at as a prediction about Jesus doesn't actually predict his death, but actually predicts his suffering in this case. Yeah. So he suffered but did not die. How do you respond?
But I just go back to what I think what's most important here is what the Jerusalem apostles were teaching. And as I showed, through Paul we can say that we can certify that he was teaching the same gospel message as the Jerusalem apostles, and they were teaching Jesus died for our sins, that he was buried, that he was raised, and that he appeared, and that those appearances were of such nature that it was a bodily resurrection.
Now, you said in your opening presentation that Jesus was Yahweh, and then you immediately added that God raised him from the dead. Yeah. So did God raise Yahweh from the dead?
Well, I think you look at it the way I see this in the scriptures is Jesus is God in some sense, that God, he's God's son. He existed in the role of God. I see it a lot. I could use the example of a marriage, and you've got two people, two separate people, but the Bible says that the two become one flesh. That doesn't mean they're joined in the flesh and all that. It means they become one unit. So the way Christians view God is that you have one God who's manifested in three distinct persons. They have different roles. The Son and the Holy Spirit are subject to the Father, but they have three separate roles, but they make up one unit, God.
So is either of them expendable? Like, could you, like, could one of them die and two of them just remain, in which case one of them is expendable?
No.
Okay. So then the one did not really die. He only kind of suspended his, like, he went to sleep for a while.
No, it's, his body died. It'd be kind of like us. I mean, I think the Christian view is when a person dies, to be absent from the body is to be at home with the Lord. So their person, the spirit, continues to live. The spirit never dies, even though the body does. So I would say the same thing with Jesus.
But wouldn't that be the earthly body that was prepared for him, which was not really God from all eternity? So that's not really God that died.
The body died, okay.
So that's not God.
The body didn't die. Well, Jesus was in the body. The body certainly died, and Jesus was under the curse of God. But God raised him from the dead and vindicated.
But then Jesus, who was the eternal spirit, as the eternal word of God.
That's right,
God,
the spirit
never died. The body never died. Only a body died.
The body died.
But that's a human body.
The human body
created
died.
In this world.
Yes.
Okay. Let's give it a hand.
So my question is for Mike. You mentioned earlier that the Quran, like based on the resurrection account, kind of rendered Jesus as a false prophet. I was just wondering if you'd elaborate on that, explain that a little bit more, and go further in depth on that argument.
Sure. Well, I think we have good reason to believe that Jesus predicted his death. For example, it's in early sources. You've got 1 Corinthians 11 as repeated by Luke in his gospel, where Jesus gives the Eucharist, you know, his body's going to be broken, his blood's going to be shed, referring to his death. You've got, so that's early source, and Paul talks about Jesus' death. It's multiple independent sources, so you do have those Eucharistic sayings in 1 Corinthians 11, Luke, and in Luke, and then you've got Mark and Matthew. Same message, but different words showing different. You can't hear me? You can't hear me? Oh, I'm sorry. So it shows different oral traditions. And then finally, you've got the embarrassing testimony in Mark chapter 11, verses 31, I think through 33, where Jesus predicts his death and resurrection. Peter rebukes him, says it shouldn't be this way. And Jesus turns around and says, "Get behind me, Satan. You're not focusing on God's interest, but your own." And so, well, the criterion of embarrassment, everything here seems to point to Jesus actually predicting these things. So, and certainly the earliest disciples, as I showed, they were preaching Jesus' death, his burial, resurrection, and appearances. So, the thing is, if Jesus did not rise from the dead, or if he did not die, let's just say, okay, well, if the Quran is correct there, then you've got Jesus' disciples who were proclaiming it, and God didn't correct them on it, okay? And he allowed the largest religion in the world to spread as a result, one to which millions of Muslims every year now in the Middle East, Africa, and Asia are coming to Christianity. So it seems like that would be a big mistake of God. God's not a smart God, the Islamic God, if he didn't correct the disciples. Moreover, the Quran refers to Jesus' disciples as Muslims on two occasions. So that would mean that God deceived those Muslims. And we can understand why God would deceive the enemies of Jesus, but why would he deceive Muslims? And if you're a Muslim in the audience today, if he's willing to deceive Jesus' disciples who are Muslims, how do you know he's not willing to deceive you? How do you know he's not deceiving you right now? So in action, what we can see here historically is if the Islamic God is correct, he is neither smart nor honest.
Defense of the Quran.
Yeah. Well, I think Mike has ignored much of the evidence that I presented during our previous discussion. I've shown good reason for thinking that Jesus did not predict his death. Notice that the Gospels and materials that he's citing are actually materials that were written many decades after Jesus. This is after Paul has preached and made the death of Jesus central to his whole teaching. So naturally, in that environment, his followers would support the idea that Jesus not only died, but seeing that he is the Son of God, he must have known in advance that he's going to die, and he deliberately went to the cross. Notice what happens when you compare the Gospels. Now, in the Garden of Gethsemane, Jesus is pleading for his life and asking, let this cup pass away from me, right? That's in the Synoptic Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke. Now, go to the last of the four Gospels, the Gospel according to John. When he enters Jerusalem in John chapter 13, he says, what shall I pray? Father, save me from this hour? No, it is for this very reason that I came to this hour. You see, the story has changed. Now, Jesus is saying, I'm deliberately going to die. I will not pray to be saved from the cross. So, that previously, he was praying to be saved from the cross. Now he's saying, I'm going there, and that's what I came into the world for. Now the whole scenario has changed so that Jesus, right from the very beginning, is declared to be the Lamb of God who will take away the sins of the world. Am I going to see my time there? Yeah? Okay, so the idea that Jesus predicted his own death, I think, is incorrect, and it is clear that the disciples were taken by surprise by the crucifixion of Jesus, and it is only the later rewriting of the story that has him predicting his death. Therefore, the Quran is not false. Thank you.
Let's have a question for Dr. Ally over here.
For Dr. Ally, if you want for Mike, you go on the other side.
Oh.
Okay, that's fine. We'll go to the next one. Go over there. You get to do it.
Hey, Dr. Ally, I just wanted to ask you a question concerning your interpretation of Scripture. I know in the Quran, 1094, so if you are in doubt, O Muhammad, about that which we have revealed to you, then ask those who have been reading the Scripture before you. The truth has certainly come to you from the Lord, so never be among the doubters. In Quran 545, and let the people of the Gospel judge by what Allah has revealed therein. And whoever does not judge by what Allah has revealed, then it is those who are that divinely disobedient. So I know Al-Badawi has said that Allah has referred to the gospel in safeguarding it, and also has said that it was used as a reminder, that which Allah has sworn to preserve, Vikar, and I think Mahmeen. So my question was, in light of that, how do you justify, or how do you reason being able to change, or that the gospel was changed so near to the source when these scriptures were written 600 years later?
So the Quran speaks respectfully about the Christian scriptures and Christian belief and Christian heroes and prophets. And of course, we need to believe in all of the scripture that was revealed by God, the Psalms of David, the Torah of Moses, the Gospel of Jesus. We need to believe in Jesus and Moses and David and Abraham. Otherwise, we wouldn't be Muslim. At the same time, the Quran shows that people have changed certain things. For example, in the second chapter of the Quran, in the 79th verse, it says, فَوَيْلُ لِلَّذِينَ يَكْتُبُونَ الْكِتَابِ بِأَيْدِيهِمْ. Woe to those who write the scripture with their own hands. ثُمَّ يَقُولُونَ هَذَا مِنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ. And then they say, this is from God. So we have to balance the two pictures. On the one hand, the Christian scripture, from a Muslim point of view, contain a very important scriptural revelation from God. But on the other hand, it's passed through human hands, and over time, changes and corruption have been crept in. Some very important teachings in the Bible are widespread. For example, the idea that Jesus is the Son of God. And the Quran is denying that Jesus is the Son of God in any way, shape, or form. It's not just giving that title at all. Even though the Quran is affirming that Jesus is the Messiah, he is a great person, worker of miracles, born of a virgin, according to most interpreters, yet the Quran is saying he's not the Son of God. Now, sometimes Christians say, well, it looks like Muhammad didn't know when he was writing the Quran that the scriptures of the Christians were different from what he's preaching, and he thought that the scriptures are all true. And it's only later on, Muslims having studied the scriptures, they thought that the scriptures have been changed. But now we're seeing that since the Quran denies the sonship of Jesus, and this is so widespread in the scriptures, then it's clear that the Quran is not agreeing with the Christian scriptures as they are. It's setting up a different worldview, but at the same time, it's doing so in a very respectful manner, to the extent that some will now use that against the Quran to say, look, but the Quran is actually approving of all of our scriptures as they are.
Right.
The Christian scriptures, contrary to Shabir, the Christian scriptures have not been corrupted over time. We have an abundance of manuscripts. We have over 5,800 manuscripts of the New Testament in its original Greek language. And even Bart Ehrman, a happy agnostic, he refers to himself, and one of the leading textual critics of the New Testament in the world, says that, you know, what we have today is essentially what was in the originals. In terms of Jesus being the Son of God, well, yeah, the Quran does deny it, but we have this in the very earliest of the Christian literature, certainly in Paul, where Jesus is the Son of God. We even have it in the earliest Gospel, Mark, and when you view it as ancient biography, as the majority of scholars do, the objective was to paint a picture of the person, the character of the person. It opens up by saying, "A voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make straight his paths." That's quoting, you know, from Isaiah, and it's talking about God, preparing the way of God. And you look all throughout the Gospel of Mark, and everything is pointing to Jesus as being God in some sense, in chapter after chapter after chapter. I wish I had more time to explain all that.
A question for Dr. Laguna?
Actually, this question is for you, Dr. Shabir, if you don't mind. I didn't realize that. I was supposed to be on the mic. Okay.
We have a pause here. We'll get the next one here, and then we'll come back to you for Shabir.
Okay.
Again, I've got a question for Mike over here, Shabir over here.
My question is that how does Christianity reconcile the problem witnesses have recognizing Jesus after his resurrection?
Okay, yeah, good question. Well, we don't know exactly. We know there's a couple of accounts, you know, they're in John, right? So the first thing with John is that Mary doesn't recognize Jesus. But, you know, the account doesn't give all the details. You have Mary go to the tomb, she sees it empty, and then she's in the tomb, and she sees the angels, and they say, you know, why are you weeping? And, you know, they've taken the Lord, and we don't know where he's at. Jesus is outside the tomb, and he says, woman, why do you weep? And she thinks he's the gardener, right? But, you know, we don't know anything about it. It could still have been, it's twilight out here, and you know, could have been wearing a hoodie or something there that would have made it so that she didn't recognize him right away. But then as soon as he said Mary, she recognized him at that point. The other account would be the Emmaus disciples in Luke chapter 24. But it says that their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And then I guess one other account would be in John chapter 21, whereas the disciples are out fishing, and Jesus is along the banks, and he's about 100 yards from them. And they don't recognize him. And it's 100 yards away. It's sunrise around that time, and you can understand why they wouldn't recognize him. I really like the way they portrayed this situation, that scene in the movie that just came out called Risen. I thought, wow, that really portrays it, how I could see John describing it and would explain why they didn't recognize him at first.
What about the recognition of Jesus?
Yeah, so to me, the best explanation for this is that Jesus was taken out of the tomb and straight up into heaven. He did not come out and meet with his disciples for 40 days and giving rise to all of these stories. No, he appeared from heaven to some of his disciples, but it was such an appearance which some people would doubt. Some would say, yeah, that's Jesus. And some would say, well, we don't know what exactly we saw. Almost like the Damascus Road experience as described for Paul in Acts of the Apostles. Those who were with him saw some light, they heard something but didn't understand, or according to another report, they heard but they didn't see. Whatever the case is, it's specific to Paul. So one person there believes, the other person doesn't really know what's going on. And that gives rise to all of these legends about Jesus meeting this person or that person, whether on the seashore in Galilee or whether here or there on earth, but it was one heavenly experience. The fact that they were not recognizing Jesus in these legends as we have them now actually is a difficulty for those who want to prove the resurrection of Jesus, because if your witnesses cannot say we saw him and we know him, then this to me is a problem.
A question for Dr. Ally over here.
Yeah, I'm not an agnostic, I'm a Christian, but my concern is, when I look at this, if I was taking the steps that Mike takes in his book, such as an explanation for it to be valuable historically, it has to be less ad hoc, explanatory scope, has to go with what we already know, have more limiting power. If I was an agnostic and I was unsure about God, but said, this Jesus fellow seems to have something to do with God if he's there, and I want to study him, it looks to me like the multiplicity of sources are unanimous that Jesus died, and that if he wasn't raised, at least his followers believe he was raised from the dead. And it looks to me like the Islamic interpretation is very ad hoc in trying to deny it was based on one source 600 years later. So if I was someone coming up as a purity from the outside, I'm curious, why should I believe the source 600 years later instead of the multiplicity of sources that I have so close to the event?
Mm-hmm. Okay. So to me, the position I've outlined actually has greater explanatory scope because it explains the development of the Gospels over time, how the stories evolved and changed, and it has great explanatory power. In that when we look at the whole situation regarding Jesus, it takes into account everything that we know, and from even from modern science. Third, it is plausible in that if you think of the Christian story that you have a dead man and then he came back to life, then unless you have good evidence for a man coming back to life, you shouldn't assert that. But if we say that this man was somehow in a sleep or in a coma, and then he came back to life, well, this happens even on our day, so it doesn't require a great stretch. This is entirely plausible. Third, it is not ad hoc in that it takes into consideration the actual materials that were there. It actually builds upon all of the evidence that's available. For example, Mike mentioned Josephus, who was an independent Jewish source. But in Josephus' reconstructed statement as found in Mike's book, it says that Jesus was crucified. It doesn't say that Jesus actually died. So he was crucified, and then he was seen alive again. Well, that's the Muslim position that I have outlined in my speech. He was crucified, but not killed on the cross. So in one interpretation, yes, he was crucified. In another, he was not, because he did not die. And then he was seen again. The Christian story is tripartite. He was crucified, then he appeared resurrected, like he was put in the tomb, dead, and then came back and lived among his disciples for a time, and then he was ascended into heaven. The idea that he was gone from crucifixion all the way up into heaven, this double, two-part story is what the Quran says. They did not kill him nor crucify him, but God raised him to himself. It's two parts. Christian story, three parts. So to me, this is entirely illuminating as well, because it helps us to understand the development of the Christian story.
Well, I would say Shabir appeals to Josephus that he was crucified, but it doesn't mean he died. Well, obviously, Josephus thought that Jesus died. All right? He's not a Christian. He's a Jewish guy. And you don't walk away from crucifixions. All right? So Josephus certainly thought Jesus had died. He talks about evolution, how the Gospels evolved and changed. Yet all of them, we could discuss that. I'd be happy to discuss that. But all of them clearly, unquestionably mentioned Jesus' death and resurrection. And that's what we're talking about here. And we can get back to the original disciples and what they were proclaiming. That Jesus died for our sins, that he was buried, that he was raised, that he appeared. And it was a physical, bodily resurrection. And Shabir never addressed what I said tonight about how the Quran borrows from legends that were circulating during the time of Jesus. Not only legends about Jesus, but legends about Alexander the Great going so far west that he saw where the sun set. It was in a warm or muddy spring. And Shabir might say, well, that's just how it appears when the sun sets in the ocean. But if you look in the Hadith, in Abu Dawud, it's very clear that Muhammad interpreted that in a literal sense. He really thought the sun set in a muddy or warm spring. And obviously, that is false.
And the question for Mike here?
You said that the Quran is not a reliable source. But the Old Testament doesn't say that Jesus is God or a part of the Trinity. Nor does it talk about his resurrection or things like that. So that's an older source that proves the Quran, really. You get what I'm saying?
No.
That's my question. Because, I mean, Jews, they don't believe that Jesus is God.
Well, neither do Muslims.
Exactly. So yeah. Jews are earlier sources. Yeah. Muslims, you know, we believe that the Quran is a revelation from God. So obviously, even though 600 years later, anything from God is the truth.
Yeah.
So it can be 1,000 years later, it doesn't matter. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah, I agree with you. The 600 years. But the problem is you've got legends in the Quran, obvious legends, where they are borrowing from legends that were about Jesus and other legends that were circulating during the life of Muhammad. And it shows that the Quran really believed these legends to be true. And like the sun setting in a muddy or warm spring. The sun doesn't set in a muddy or warm spring, and yet this is what Muhammad believed because he heard from the glorious deeds of Alexander and he believed it.
But I mean,
it's not the word of God.
The same thing with the Son of God. I mean, it can be just the same way he saw the sun, you know, laying on the mud. That's kind of like the same argument.
No, because I can show historically where Jesus actually claimed to be the Son of God. It's in early sources. It's in multiple independent sources. We've got all good evidence. Plus, you have all the earliest Christians. We can show through Paul and the disciples that they thought Jesus was God in some sense. Well, these were pious Jews. How on earth did they come to this? Their earliest belief was that Jesus was God in some sense, unless Jesus himself claimed this. So there's really good reason, historically speaking, to think that Jesus did claim to be God's uniquely divine Son.
But does the Jews believe that, or is it taught in the Old Testament that Jesus was going to be resurrected?
Well, the Christians went back and interpreted Psalm 16:10 and Psalm 2:7, but no, I don't think there's any clear scriptures in the Old Testament that would seem to suggest that the Messiah was going to rise from the dead.
So it's totally different from the Christian teaching, which can be very confusing because, you know, if Jews have a certain way of believing, and then all of a sudden Jesus is God, as a Muslim, I could see where the older source teaches something totally different.
Okay, well, you believe the Quran teaches something totally different than what the Jewish Old Testament does. So if what you're saying applies to the New Testament, it also applies to the Quran. So your argument, if the New Testament, because it doesn't agree with the Old Testament, let's just say I grant that, I'm not sure that I do, but if it disagrees with the Old Testament, that means the New Testament is wrong. Well, then if the Quran disagrees with the Old Testament, it would mean the Quran is wrong. So you disprove your own book.
Here, what about the Old Testament?
Okay, so what I would say is that the Quran actually reaffirms the original teachings that were proclaimed by the great prophets of old in the Old Testament and also finally by Jesus. The questioner is right. There is nothing in the Old Testament that indicates that God is a Trinity or that God has a literal son up there with him in heaven who might be called the Word of God. Notice that the idea that Jesus is the Word of God, the Logos, is only found in the fourth gospel, the gospel according to John. Again, we're seeing development after development in many different streams. If Jesus was the Word of God, you would expect him to say that to somebody, I am the Word of God. But he never says that in any gospel, not even in the fourth, which proclaims him to be the Word of God. And so it is clear then that the Quran, in declaring that Jesus is a servant and Messiah and the messenger of God, is actually reaffirming original teachings. And I'm glad that Mike has said that the Old Testament did not speak about Jesus resurrecting from the dead. Now the question is, did the Old Testament speak about him dying? And my answer from the Psalms and Isaiah that I've cited is no.
Another question for Dr. Ally over here.
Dr. Ally, it was a pleasure to hear you speaking again. And Dr. Licona, thank you again for coming. The question I have is, in the last portion of your questions to Dr. Licona, you were pressing a matter dealing with Jesus' body, his spirit, the resurrection, and I'm wondering, are you trying to pull out something theological or in question relating to the resurrection or rescue question that we're talking about here tonight, and what you were trying to get out of that, as well as Dr. Licona, your response, is there any theological implications that we should be aware of from your response? I'm really curious if you guys can kind of hash that out.
Yes. Of course, Mike is very much interested in the history, and I'm glad we discussed that for the most part. But of course, there are theological connections, and Mike made that evident from the very inception of his opening presentation, if you recall. So there are theological problems with saying that Jesus died, and those problems are avoided by saying that God rescued and saved Jesus, as I have outlined. What are the problems? Now, if you say that God had Jesus die, then that gives rise to what we know now to be Christian theology. And many Christians are now questioning traditional theology. For example, Steve Chalk, who is known to be an evangelical scholar in the United Kingdom, has written a book entitled The Lost Teachings of Jesus. And in that book, he's cautioning his fellow evangelicals that they should not say that God had Jesus die so that that would appease the wrath of God, which has been a common way in the Middle Ages to speak about Jesus' death. He says, because this would make it appear like cosmic child abuse. the Father using the Son for his own purposes to get rid of his own anger. And we find that there are problems like this. Now, of course, there are other related problems like with the Trinity, because if you say that only God can die for your sins, and therefore God had to come down and die, and then in the final analysis we find out that it's not God who actually died, it's just the human body that was prepared for him here on earth that he associated with in some way, and then he left that human body just like the clothes we wear. We put it on, we take it off, he goes back to his heavenly body. So these are deep theological problems, and the escape from these problems is to recognize that Luke's gospel does not present Jesus as dying for the sins of the world, but rather Luke has a martyr theology where Jesus dies as a martyr. That's why in Luke's gospel it doesn't say I've come as to give my life as a ransom for many. It says I've come to serve. And so Luke's gospel has in chapter 15 the story of the prodigal son, which means that when you sin, you turn back to God, he forgives you, nobody pays for your sins.
Well, it's interesting that he says it only talks about he came to serve but not give his life as a ransom. Because the whole saying that he came not to be served, but to serve, but to give his life a ransom for many, that's in Mark. And it's without it, that's in Luke. But Shabir, in his statement, he says, he keeps saying that the gospel's evolved. So if that's the case, why is it now that he wants to believe Luke, but not Mark? Luke's the later gospel. It's the criterion of convenience. You only do what is convenient with your own view. It's not historical investigation that leads him to that conclusion. He says there's theological problems if Jesus died. Well, not in the Christian view, but there are theological problems in the Muslim view if he did not die. Because remember, Jesus' disciples were proclaiming that he died. And so that would mean that God deceived Jesus' disciples. God's a deceiver, and the Quran refers to them as Muslims. And that means God's willing to deceive Muslims. So he could be deceiving you if you're a Muslim. It also renders Jesus a false prophet since Jesus predicted his death. So God is neither honest he's not honest, and Jesus is a false prophet. Cosmic child abuse, well, if you were a father and you had a billion wayward children, and the only way for them to be rescued from damnation would be for your innocent son to give his life for them, and your innocent son was willing to, would you be a good father if you prohibited and stopped him from doing that?
Another question for Dr. Mendoza.
I have 2 points. I need some clarification on them of what I've understood from the debate. You said Jesus already expected his death and resurrection. So the first point, how did his fellows treat that when he was nailed to the cross? Because did they say, like, he is nailed, yeah, he's going to resurrect. That's what he told us. Or the second point is, how did Mark describe the resurrection on his book, because since he's the first gospel?
Okay, well, in terms of why the disciples didn't seem to be expecting Jesus' resurrection if he predicted it, I think that's fair. That is a difficult question for me to answer, I must admit, because you would think that they would be a little more, expectant, positive about it. My only guess on that would be that, just like Peter, when Jesus is predicting his death, he says, no, it can't be this way. They're expecting a conquering Messiah. That was the conception of the Messiah. And they're just not getting it. And they don't seem to understand it until after Jesus has been raised from the dead. Oh, okay. I understand now what's going on. So, and then they more fully believed the claims about himself at that point. Things started to just come together for them after that. That would be my guess. In terms of why Mark doesn't mention a resurrection narrative, well, he does mention a resurrection narrative, he just doesn't mention the appearance. But Mark obviously knows about the appearance because he, several times throughout his gospel, he mentions Jesus predicting his death and resurrection. Mark chapter 8, verse 30, 31, 32, 33, and following. Mark chapter 9, verse 30, 31, and following several times. Mark chapter 14, verse 28, he says, after I've been raised from the dead, I will meet you in Galilee. And then that's why in chapter 16, verse 7, the angel tells him, hey, he's going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him just as he told you. Now, why isn't the appearance narrated? Well, I think it's probable. I mean, scholars are split on this. Did Mark intend for his gospel to end there? An increasing number of scholars, even prominent scholars, think that Mark's ending has either been lost or that Mark was unable to complete his gospel. So that's where I think the number of scholars who think that he ended his gospel at chapter 16, verse 8, their reasons for saying Mark ended it there, there are more reasons posited than there are scholars. So, but I tend to think that the ending was probably lost or not completed, and that's why it's there. Who knows, maybe Matthew preserves Mark's lost ending.
Shabir?
Yeah, so, and this is a difficult problem. If you say that Jesus predicted his death on three separate occasions in such a pointed manner, and also his resurrection to follow from the death, and yet his disciples don't seem to know it, then this is a problem. The solution is to recognize that what we have in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John are not necessarily the original stories, not even what we have in Acts of the Apostles. So whereas we find Luke, Mike insisting that Jesus did predict his death and resurrection, this could not have been the case. When the women went to the tomb and found it empty and came back and reported to the disciples, according to Luke's gospel, the disciples took it for nonsense. Why should they not reflect at this point and realize, oh yeah, Jesus in three separate times told us that he's going to resurrect from the dead? No, it means that he never said that, but this is later on rewritten back into the story, written into the story. So just because it's in Mark doesn't mean it's original. We have to trace it from these Gospels what was the original story. The original story was not that Jesus would die, but that God would preserve him.
We have time for just two more questions now, so let's take one for Dr. Ally over here.
Well, Dr. Ally, thank you very much for coming this evening. What I'm about to say is something I've heard from Christians about Islam. So I'm hoping for a better view on this. My understanding is one of the biggest problems that Muslims have with the idea of Jesus dying by crucifixion is that Allah would not allow a prophet to be so horribly humiliated as Jesus was. But it seems like he got that humiliation, whether he was executed in the process or whether he was just whipped, sent through the streets and hung naked on the cross. Either way, he got the humiliation. Is humiliation an issue? And if so, why would hanging on the cross without dying be an acceptable way around it?
Yeah, so the problem of the humiliation, obviously, here is difficult for all of us, whether Muslim or Christian. We would all like to see a good man coming out without a scratch. But bad things do happen to good people, as the title of Harold Kushner's book suggests. And in Jesus' suffering and humiliation, if that's what he went through, in fact, there is a lesson for all of us. But the lesson is driven home more clearly if, in fact, God rescued him from before he actually died. It tells a person who is suffering and in excruciating pain that you don't worry. God can take care of you if, indeed, that would be good for you. But perhaps God has a better plan and he wants to take you in your sleep or in your death as he took Jesus. The idea that Jesus was resurrected back from the dead rang through with people at the time because Paul saw this as the onset of the day of judgment. He saw that Jesus was going to come back any time now and scoop up the rest of his followers, those in the tombs already would resurrect. And Paul includes himself as the we among those whom, according to 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 17, would be raptured up with Jesus into heaven. But of course, that didn't happen in Paul's lifetime and for 2,000 years. And now the story is not looking as good as it once looked. Resurrection looked fine at the time because Jesus was the first fruits of all of those who are to be resurrected. But now, if we look at the reality of our situation, we are suffering and we want God to rescue us and save us and reverse some disease or illness that we have, well then that's exactly the story of the Psalms which I've been quoting. Psalm 16, 22. Psalm 40 and 70, Psalm 118, all of which have something to do with the gospel presentation and the presentation of Acts of the Apostles regarding what happened to Jesus. So while we would like that Jesus should not have gone through this humiliation, God has something better in his plan and a lesson for us in his suffering.
All Shabir can do in order to call into question Jesus' death and resurrection is to appeal to a hypothetical pre-market and Q source, both of which, any evidence for them, exist in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, sources that all talk about Jesus' death and resurrection. It's very dubious that they would appeal so much to a pre-market and Q source if it disagreed with their primary message that Jesus died and rose from the dead. And besides, you've got Paul, who we are able to, through Paul, to get back to what the Jerusalem apostles, those who knew Jesus, they were proclaiming Jesus' death
and resurrection. And so the bottom line is, if, since we know this is what the disciples were preaching, if Jesus did not die, then God allowed the disciples to spread this message and become the largest religion in the world, to which millions of Muslims every year are coming. So that makes God not very smart to allow that. Plus, he deceived the earliest disciples, who the Quran refers to as Muslims. And so if the Quran is correct, then that means the Islamic God is neither smart nor honest.
Final question right here.
John 19 tells the account of a soldier piercing the side of Jesus with a spear while he hangs on the cross. That speaks directly to him being dead rather than just in a coma or taken up into heaven before dying. Is there a reason that wasn't mentioned in your arguments before?
Well, it isn't John, and I like to say, you know, look, I believe the Gospels are historically reliable. That does not necessarily require that everything in the Gospels are true. It doesn't mean that there wasn't any kind of embellishments or legend. I'm not saying there's embellishments or legend. I'm just saying it doesn't rule anything out like that. Okay, but what my emphasis on is, what can we get back to what the Jerusalem apostles were saying? And they were saying that Jesus died by crucifixion, that he rose from the dead and appeared to others, and this was a bodily resurrection event. And so, you know, not trying to prove every detail that's in there. Personally, I believe the spear wound happened, okay? But it's irrelevant for establishing that Jesus died and rose from the dead. All I was doing is saying this is what the earliest Christians, Jesus' apostles, were proclaiming. They were proclaiming his death and resurrection.
What about John's account of the spear wound?
Yeah. Most historians say that the spear wound mentioned in John's Gospel is not historical. John has mentioned this for theological reasons, and this is why Mike has hesitated in his answer regarding that, rather than boldly saying right from the very beginning, yeah, that's true, it happened, and that proves that Jesus died. He said it in the end, but not boldly from the beginning, only after some hesitation, because he's aware of this being the scholarly conclusion. And that means that minus the spear wound, we do not have any real cause of Jesus' death. So Raymond Brown, in his Death of the Messiah, is asking, we must wonder what caused the death of the Lord, because crucifixion pierces no vital organ. So that supports my thesis that Jesus was not dead, but he was taken up alive. Mike saying that the disciples were deceived is based on his understanding of what the disciples were preaching from the Gospels and Acts of the Apostles. But I'm saying the original disciples were not deceived. They know what was going on. They knew that Jesus was taken up alive.
Please join me in giving a hand from these wonderful speakers.